Okay, so let us understand how one can measure the pKa of given compound by using UV spectroscopy, a very simple technique and very effective and accurate too. So we understand the importance of the pKa in case of, let us say, reverse phase chromatography. You will be able to estimate the percent ionization if you know the pKa value and the pH. So let us understand how one can use UV spectroscopy technique for measurement of the pKa. So as per as the possibility of using UV spectroscopy for measurement of the pKa, this is the prerequisite. Your compound must exhibit pH dependent UV spectrum. Now what this indicates? This indicates that you must get the variation into the absorbance value by changing the pH. So for example, if you have a pH solution of 1.0, and in case if the absorbance of your compound at pH 1.0 is, let us say, 0.1. Now if you change the pH to 5, and if you get the absorbance of, let us say, 0.5, that indicates that your compound exhibits the pH dependent absorbance value, the pH dependent UV spectrum, and hence your compound is suitable for using UV spectroscopy for measurement of the pKa. The second step is, now you need to select the suitable wavelength and the pH range. So how one can select the suitable wavelength? You can scan the sample from 200 to 400 nanometer in case of UV spectroscopy, and then determine which wavelength is suitable for the measurement. It can be one of your lambda max. The third point is, you need to select one acidic buffer and one basic buffer along with seven other buffers. So what is the purpose of selecting one highly acidic buffer? Let us say 0.1 normal sodium hydroxide, sodium chloride, and the highly basic buffer like 0.1 normal sodium hydroxide. It may not be buffer, but it can be highly acidic solution and highly basic solution. The purpose is, you need to have the extreme cases in which your substance, your compound, either will be 100% ionized or it can be either 100% non-ionized. Let us take an example. For example, if your compound is a weak base, so what is going to happen? The weak base, when it goes into a 0.1 normal hydrochloric acid solution, it will get completely ionized. So it will be for sure 100% ionized. And what is going to happen with the same compound into the 0.1 normal sodium hydroxide solution, a highly basic solution? As your compound is a weak base, it will be 100% non-ionized, so that your compound now has extreme ionization stages. In one stage, it is 100% ionized, and in another state, it is 100% non-ionized. The second scenario could be, in case if your compound is a weak acid, what is going to happen to the weak acid in the 0.1 normal hydrochloric acid solution? It is going to be 100% non-ionized. Similarly, the weak acid will be a 100% ionized in case of 0.1 normal sodium hydroxide solution. So in any given case, either weak base or weak acid, you will achieve the extreme stages of the ionization in strong acid and strong base solution. So that is the purpose of selecting these two extreme acidic and basic solutions. I hope you are clear about the selection of these extreme acidic and basic solutions. The second is what now? You need to select the appropriate seven other buffers. See, during the selection of the seven other buffers, they must be, their pH values must be close to the estimated approximate pKa values. Now this statement is very important. The pH of the seven buffers must be close to the estimated rough pKa values. Then you must have the question that, see, I haven't started the experiment of measuring the pKa, and you are talking about understanding the estimated value. The estimated pKa value can be measured with a rough experiment. How one can conduct a rough experiment? For example, rather than selecting the 7 appropriate buffers, you will select the 7 buffers from the range of pH 1 to pH 12 and run the rough experiment, pilot experiment, and then based on that, you will understand the approximate pKa value. And if you understand that, okay, now in this particular compound, my pKa looks to be around 5 or around 6. So this becomes your rough estimation of the pKa value. And once you understand this rough pKa value operator, say 5, then decide the 7 different pHs very close to the 5. For example, 5 plus or minus 0.2, 5 plus or minus 0.4, and 5 plus or minus 0.6. So you are going to have the 7 different buffers with the help of rough estimation of the pKa value. So once you have the 1 acidic, 1 basic solution and the 5 pH buffers, 7 different pH buffers, then you need to go to the next level. So we have fixed now the 7 pH buffers, and we also have the 2 buffers, which is one is highly acidic and another one is highly basic buffers. So highly acidic buffer can be, let us say, 0.1 normal hydrochloric acid, and the highly basic buffer can be, let us say, 0.1 normal sodium hydroxide. So this fulfills our the buffers requirement. So you need to prepare the sample into this 7 plus 2 buffers, right, of the suitable concentration, and then measure the absorbance value at the selected wavelength. Then once you have the absorbance value, you need to also measure the pH of each and every solution. Okay, so once you measure the pH, you need to plot a graph of pH, observed pH value versus the absorbance value at the 7 corresponding buffers. You need to plot the graph of the only 7 buffers. You need not to plot the graph with the highly acidic and highly basic buffer, that is not required. So plot the graph of the observed pH value versus the absorbance for only 7 buffers. So it is always recommended to conduct the study at 2 different concentrations. For example, one is 10 ppm, another can be, let us say, 50 ppm. Now use Albert Sargent equation to determine the pKa. It is very important to understand what this equation looks like. So this is the Albert Sargent equation, and with this equation, you will be able to measure the pKa by UV spectroscopic method. So pKa in case of weak acid is equal to pH plus log to the base 10 of Ai minus A divided by A minus Am. Now what is the pH? So pH is what? The value recorded onto the pH meter for the selected buffer. A stands for absorbance of the compound in the selected buffer. Am stands for the absorbance of unionized molecule. Do you remember we talked about the highly acidic and highly basic buffers? That could be the reason of this Am value. And Ai stands for absorbance of ionized molecule. So this is the equation for measuring the pKa of the weak acidic compound. For the weak basic compound, this is the pKa. pKa equal to pH plus log to the base 10 of Am minus A divided by A minus Ai. So with this example, you will be able to measure the pKa of weakly acidic or weakly basic compound. So let me explain you with the help of simple calculations that how you can measure the pKa now. So let us go to the Excel sheet, and here we go with the Excel sheet. So I have taken the example of weak base sample. Let's assume that your sample is a weak base, and in that case, your AM, right, the absorbance value of unionized compound is what, 0.418. So if the compound is weak base, and if this is AM value, the absorbance of unionized compound, now in which pH the basic compound will remain unionized? It is the basic compound, basic pH, right? So it must be a pH belongs to the basic solution. For example, the point over normal sodium hydroxide solution. AI stands for absorbance of the compound into ionized form. And this must be the value of the absorbance into a highly acidic solution. So you must able to understand one important thing, that you have to have the absorbance because of the completely ionized solution and the completely unionized solution at the extreme of the absorbance, the extreme of the ionization states. So this is what the AM. AM stands for the absorbance value of the compound into unionized state, and AI stands for the absorbance of the value into completely ionized state. And in case of weak base, right, the completely unionized state will be possible into highly basic solution. Similarly, in case of weak base, the completely ionized state is possible into a highly acidic solution. So once you got these values now, let us now prepare the suitable 7 different pH buffers. And with the help of the rough estimation, right, we have to conduct the one rough estimation. We understand probably the pKa of the compound is going to be, let us say, the pKa 5. So I am going to prepare the pH solutions across the 5. Let us say plus or minus 0.2, plus or minus 0.4, and plus or minus 0.6. Around that. And then I have selected to prepare these 7 pH buffers. Now, once I have the 7 pH buffers ready, I am going to prepare the solution of my compound by using these different 7 pH buffers. And then I'm going to measure the absorbance for all these 7 different solutions. So these are the absorbance values. So for pH 4.3, the absorbance value is 0.207. Similarly, for pH 4.5, the absorbance value is 0.22. So now I have the absorbance value for all these 7 different pH solutions. I have the absorbance value for highly acidic and highly basic solutions. Now, the first step is what? I need to calculate the AM minus A. The purpose of calculating AM minus A, it is a part of my pKa estimation formula. So this is the AM minus A. Similarly, I will calculate A minus AI and look at the values over here. Now, calculate the ratio of AM minus A by A minus AI. Then take the logarithm of these values, and these are the logarithm values of AM minus A divided by A minus AI. I am only doing this because it is part of the calculation formula. And look at the pKa calculation formula now. The pKa is equal to, as it is a weak base, right? It is pH plus log of AM minus A by AM A minus AI. Just look at this on the screen over here. And then you will find the 7 different pKa values. At pH 4.3, I got the pKa of 4.04. At pH 4.5, the 5.09. So I have the now all 7 pKa values across the 7 pH buffers. And then take the mean of the 7 pKa values, and it comes to be now 5.07. So this is the way one can easily understand and calculate the pKa value with a simple experiment of the UV spectroscopy. You can run the similar experiment once again with the another concentration to just understand that you are not getting wrong pKa value. So conduct the experiment by two different concentrations. If one is with 50 ppm, conduct the another one with, let us say, 100 ppm. And then understand how much is the pKa value you are getting. So this is a graph that I plot, the pH versus absorbance value. This is called as a sigmoid curve. And you can also calculate the pKa value by calculating the inflection, right? By calculating the inflection, you will also be able to calculate the pKa value. So this is a simple way of measuring the pKa by using UV spectroscopy. So I hope you must have got an idea how you can use UV spectroscopy for measurement of pKa value for your compound. So thank you very much for watching this video, and I will meet you soon with such kind of informative and useful video. Till then, take care and bye-bye. See you soon.